when you first come to this practice, the first time you sit in cross-legged posture, and for a little while thereafter, it can be a little difficult. It can be uncomfortable. And everybody knows that. And I just want to say, if you experience that, don't be discouraged. It gets easier. Have some patience if you feel this kind of discomfort when you first start to practice. Your legs are not used to it, but they will become used to it. Looking around at the world today, it looks like it's in absolute chaos, wherever you go. There's difficult, harmful things taking place, suffering is being created. It looks like this world is not a very friendly place, but the truth is that everything in this world is in perfect harmony. Inherently, there is perfect harmony among all beings and among all things. But because we have desires and ambitions and judgments, we don't feel the harmony. These things get in the way. The mind's discriminating activity gets in the way of seeing things as they are. So we see instead, or our mind sees chaos, doesn't see harmony. And that means we will lose any interest. We run the risk of losing interest in keeping harmony because we don't think it's there. So this is a big problem. Inherent harmony is not easy to understand, and it's not easy to accept unless we see the world through the eyes and ears of practice. So normally our view of the things of the world is almost entirely objective and logical, analytical, so-called common sense. And it seems to us when we see the world this way that everything is independent. Things are separate. That's the common sense conclusion we come to when we look at the world with our eyes and our other senses. Things are totally independent of each other, we think. And we think that separation is our true state. This is the big delusion. But actually, all things are interdependent, not independent. All things are interdependent. All things are dependent on each other. We are all dependent on each other. And it's because everything changes. The truth of reality, according to Buddhism, and just observing. And just experiencing the world, everything changes constantly. Everything is changing. And it means that because all things are constantly changing, they cannot be independent. In Buddhism, we say that all things are transient and all things are temporary. And this transient, temporary nature of each thing, the temporary existence of each thing is defined by the transient existence of all other things. Moment by moment in our transiency and our impermanence, we are defined by all other transient, impermanent beings. And it means that nothing, not one of us, nothing in this world has its own unique or special value. We are defined by each other, which is another way of saying interdependent. So our practice is to let go of ideas of a separate and independent self, and to see our independence, interdependency. It means we try to let go of ideas that all things have an independent self. So instead, our way is to learn to see Buddha in all things, to see the common nature of all things, to see Buddha in all things, even in the smallest insect or spot of dust. And it means everything is Buddha, inherently. And our practice is about nurturing, uncovering and nurturing this understanding. So when we take care of things in our life with care, with mindfulness, when we take care of things with care, we are taking care of Buddha. To pay respect to everything that exists, to pay respect to everything that we do, is to pay homage to Buddha. To pay homage to Buddha is not just to bow to Buddha's statue. Much more than that. We don't need a statue of Buddha to be present to pay respect to Buddha, because Buddha is all things. We pay respect to all things. So we pay homage, not just in this zendo or in some ceremony, but in all activities of life, we pay homage to harmony. In the midst of chaos, we pay respect to harmony by treating things and people and activities with respect. So our practice is to treat everything the same way we would treat Buddha if he were to appear right here. So instead of simply respecting the things of this world one at a time, we start by respecting our practice. Because without our practice as the basis of our activity, things don't mean so much. So we practice, we do this practice to acknowledge the deepest meaning of our everyday world. Not just its superficial appearance, but the deepest meaning of our everyday world. And when we practice and bring that practice into our everyday life, things have meaning. So when we offer our efforts and our attitude with respect, it means we are expressing our compassionate mind, our caring mind. To have a caring mind It's easy to have a caring mind when we offer flowers. We love flowers. So we arrange flowers in some beautiful way, and we like how they adorn our altar, and we like how they adorn our home. So we give our attention to flowers when we arrange them. But can we offer our daily effort in this way when there are no flowers? When it's other people who we have to arrange? When it's other people that we want to adorn our life? Can we have the same attitude towards other people as we have to beautiful flowers? Especially when ambition arises and competition arises. Our flower does not compete with us. And our cat or our dog does not compete with us. So it's very easy to love them without reservation. But with other people, it's not always so easy. When we start by respecting our practice, and we continue our practice with trust, we can see everything as they are. We can see all things as they are, including other people. And we see that everything is Buddha. And everything is worthy of our care and respect. And we see that all things are not independent from each other or from ourselves. When we can feel the interdependency, there is no feeling of separation and no feeling of competition. There's just warmth and respect. So to practice our way, and to have this viewpoint, to have this Buddhist worldview, we need to appreciate emptiness and understand what the Buddhists call emptiness. Emptiness of all things. And to do so, we have to let go, not be dependent on the objective view of the world, the rational view of the world. We don't have to give it up. We just have to be careful not to be dependent on it. Because the objective, rational view of the world is where everything seems permanent. And it seems like everything has some unique core and everything is independent. And this is the beginning of difficulties. So we start by appreciating that everything is changing. But of course, at the very same time, we have to talk about things as if they were substantial and as if they were independent, because that's how we live together in this world. That's the way we speak of things when we relate to each other. So even though things are impermanent, and things are changing, and everything is inherently empty, in daily life we treat them objectively, so that we can do things with each other. When we respect all things by appreciating their true nature, there's no problem going back and forth between substantial and empty. We go back and forth. So if we want to live in this world, if we want to have continuous freedom in this world, we have to make a continuous effort. And we may not achieve great success in our daily ventures. We may not become famous or well-known. But when we sincerely work on the difficulties that arise in our life, when we sincerely work on them, this is how we go beyond the difficulties. And here's where we find freedom of mind. Quite often somebody will ask the question, does there have to be suffering? Why is there suffering? Does there have to be suffering? And when we stop to reflect on the nature of our life and how we grow in wisdom, we realize that in our life troubles are necessary for us. Troubles are necessary for us so that we can learn the meaning of making an effort. The Buddhist way of life is one continuous effort, one thing after the other, one continuous effort. And we say sometimes we make our effort moment after moment, but actually there's no such thing as moments. There's just the continuous forever. In other words, the present never ceases. We are always in the present. Freedom means to be content with our present life, whatever it is. To be content with our present life. To be untroubled, even though we may not have very much. And even though we may have ideas for how we can improve our life. Freedom is to be satisfied with what we have in the present. We don't have to give up ideas for improving our life, but it's important to be satisfied with what we have in this moment and in this present. Then we can respect our life. And we can find wisdom. And when we are satisfied with our life in this way, there are no desires. And that's how we cut off the source of suffering. So, no, there doesn't have to be suffering, but it means we have to learn how to take care of the troubles that arise and how to make our effort. But if we lose respect for what we're doing, if we lose respect for our practice and respect for all things with which we are interdependent, if we lose that respect, if we don't see things as they are, if we lose our way, it will be hard to be helped by someone's kindness when we ourselves have a difficulty. The only way of help is continuous effort, whatever is our situation. And we need to rely on our own efforts to settle our own life, even though we may receive some help from time to time. We have to rely on our own efforts to settle our life. So people will help us when we have difficulty, but their help to us is only temporary. Because true help is more than just fixing some problem that has arisen at the moment. True true help comes from understanding how we limit ourselves. How is it that we see chaos in the world when it's inherently in harmony? We need to understand how we limit ourselves in that way. And we need to work on relieving those limitations. Material limitations, emotional limitations, and especially spiritual limitations. So it's absolutely necessary to have the proper attitude. Which is greatly helped through our spiritual practice. Our practice teaches us about attitude. So we have our practice and we engage in it every day. And we have to be careful not to expect anything of value to come from it. No fame, no power, no wealth, not even appreciation. Expect nothing from our practice. Because our practice is about not acquiring something, but unmasking our own inherent wisdom. This is our practice. Wisdom by itself does not achieve anything. It simply sees the world as it is. So wisdom by itself is not something that solves problems. It enables us to see the world as it is, so that we can figure out ourselves how to take care of our problems. And we each have to make our own effort to gain this understanding, to not be sidetracked by our own creative and thinking mind, not to be sidetracked. We have to make our own effort. And when we sincerely make our effort, our wisdom will show us what to do. But without our continual effort, there can be no wisdom.